So far, what we have been doing is to solve the Schrödinger equation for a variety of different potentials. However, now we want to begin going a bit further, but for that, we need to first understand a little bit about the mathematical background of quantum mechanics. So in this video, I'm going to begin a series of a few videos where we will discuss precisely this, and that is the mathematical background that we need in order to, most importantly, generalize some of the concepts that we have seen, because that will allow us to free ourselves a little bit of some of the notation that we were using it was limiting us a little bit. This will make more sense in the future when we already did this, so let's just dive straight in. So the first step, the first thing that we need to do is to check out the Hilbert space. So the Hilbert space, what exactly is it and why do we care about it? So in quantum mechanics, the state of a system is given by what we call the state vector. Indicates the state of a system. So we're going to have these state vectors, and there's a second very important element that we have seen, and those are the operators. Because the operators act on the state vectors. That's what we have seen so far. And for example, some of the operators that we saw were the momentum operator and the position operator, just to name those two. So we have those elements that are crucial to what we have been doing so far. So if we want to generalize these concepts, we need to understand a little bit more about those elements. And in particular, what we need is to see where these elements live, where do they reside, and what properties do they have. And the answer to that is that these elements live in something that is called the Hilbert space. The Hilbert space is a linear vector space. Now, you might have heard that before in some sort of linear algebra course, and if you want to take a closer look at that, I do think it might be worth a shot, but to be honest, we are not going to go too much into the mathematical definition of a space, because we want to just see what the properties are and how we can use them. So we are more interested in the physical part than the mathematical part of it. That's something that physicists do a lot. We kind of just hope for the best and don't really look too much at the mathematical part. Obviously that is something that might be improved, but that's the way we are sometimes. So the Hilbert space is a linear vector space, and the idea of it is that it generalizes the Euclidean space. That is something that we were probably familiar with, because this is what we're seeing when we have these two-dimensional or three-dimensional spaces. And maybe you have not seen it explicitly called that, but that is what you have most certainly seen at some point. And now that we generalize it, we can not only work with two or three dimensions, but a Hilbert space can have any finite or even infinite dimension. And this is going to have many powerful applications that we will see in just a minute. So the Hilbert space, as I said, has all the properties of the linear vector space. And another important thing is that it has a defined scalar product. Now, this is what we have also referred to in the past as the inner product. And this scalar product is going to be strictly positive. That is also something that you have probably seen before. This dot product, as it's sometimes called in other contexts, is also strictly positive, and so is this scalar product. For now, we are going to write it as parentheses of some vector, let's call it psi, and some other vector, let's say phi. So that's how we're going to call it for now. In the next video, we're actually going to begin talking about the Dirac notation, so we will change this, but just for now, we'll call it like this. And this result is going to be, in the most general form, some complex number. That's going to be the result of this operation, some complex number. And it's important to note that order matters, because the inner product between psi and phi is not necessarily the same as the inner product between phi and psi. It might be similar in some cases, but in general, it's not true. But when is it true? Now, what is the inner product? The inner product that we wrote like this is going to be, we take this first part and we multiply it by the second vector phi. Now, you might remember in the dot product where you multiplied one vector by the other and you had to add each of these components. That's basically the procedure. Now, we know that when we're dealing with complex vectors, we have to take the complex conjugate of the first. So we see this form. What happens now if we take the inner product between phi and psi? Now, this would be the complex conjugate of phi times psi. So if we want these two quantities to be equal, we need the complex conjugate of psi to be the same as psi, and we're going to need phi conjugate to be the same as phi. So basically, these quantities have to be real for these two operations to be the same. So that's the condition, but it's not the most important thing. It's just like a comment I wanted to note, but that's something you can just see by yourself. So another important thing is that the scalar product of some vector with itself is always positive. So the scalar product of, let's say, psi with psi, this is always going to be greater or equal to zero. This is always going to be a positive real number. This is something that we have written before as the modulus of psi squared. And this has to be greater or equal to zero. And the only way for this to be zero is if this vector psi itself is zero. In this case, it will be obviously the vector zero. Okay, so that's the first thing that we need to know about Hilbert spaces. Now we want to go into what is actually most important to us, which is a subspace of the Hilbert spaces, and that is the function spaces. The function spaces. Now, function spaces are very, very similar to what we already saw, except that the element of a function space is not going to be a vector, it's going to be a function. And more particularly, it's going to be a complex function. That is the element of this space. So most of the rules that we already saw apply because this is a subspace of the Hilbert space, so of course they must apply as well, otherwise it wouldn't be part of the Hilbert space. But let us discuss one of the most important properties, and that I want to here put explicitly, because that is going to be the inner product once again. So the inner product between two complex functions, psi and phi, this is going to be the integral now, instead of just the normal sum that was kind of implicit in the other notation, between the complex conjugate that now depends on x times phi of x dx. And this is something that you might recognize, and we are going to get to that in a second, so let's not get ahead of ourselves. Now, if this integral diverges, right, if this integral does not have a finite number as a solution, then that means that this inner product doesn't exist. If this goes to infinity, the inner product doesn't exist. So in order for a function to be part of this function space, we are going to require that the inner product of the function with itself, it has to exist. So the inner product, which we can now write as just the modulus squared dx, this will have to exist. And what that is something that we are going to call, if a function that satisfies this, is what we call a square integrable function, right? So this has to have a finite limit. And you, I hope this rings a bell, because many times in the past, when in the previous videos here in the quantum mechanics series, we saw some answer. For example, we saw, okay, we have some psi, that is some constant e to the bx, and we wanted to see what happens when x goes to infinity, for example. And we saw that this quantity would go to infinity, which means that it was not normalizable. And now we know that that means that this function right here was not square integrable. And that is extremely important. That is kind of the takeaway here, that in the all these functions here in these function spaces have to be square integrables. And that is why the wave functions that we were seeing in the previous videos, when we were finding these wave functions, they had to converge when we took this integral. The integral had to converge, otherwise they just were not valid solutions for these function spaces, because they would also not represent real physical states. Okay, so that is the basis here of the Hilbert space and the function spaces. As you see, it is not too mathematically intense at all, and in fact, it is quite rare that we want to go too much into the mathematical definition of these spaces. What is important is that we know its properties, and with this we can now set up one of the most important things, and that is the Dirac notation, and also discussing the operators. That is something we will do in the next few videos. So I will see you then.